March 21st. I ask everyone please rise for the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you, everyone. I will entertain a motion to approve the payroll warrant for 314, expense warrant. It just has an amount. Carrie, would you know? Is Carrie in here?
I'm sorry, what's your question?
There's two expense warrants. One just has a price.
43/518/28.
Is there a date to that one?
I believe that is...
Same date?
21.
Same date?
No,
so the 14th?
Yeah.
So 314 and expense warrant for, thank you, Carrie, for 321.
I'll make that motion.
Second.
Any discussion? Hearing none, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Entertain a motion to approve the select amendments for 2/21/17.
I'll make the motion.
Second.
Any discussion?
Nope.
Hearing none, all in favor?
Aye.
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 Entertain a motion to acknowledge the reports for the Personnel Committee for the dates listed on the agenda.
I'll make the motion.
Second.
Any discussion? If not, all in favor?
Aye.
Anybody wish to address the board this evening? Welcome, sir. Or ma'am, I'm sorry. Welcome. I saw Dave in the back.
I'm Janice Wilson, 20 East Main Street.
Welcome.
And I came here to speak in favor of keeping Peter Partell as our fire chief. I have a few petitions here from the citizens of the town.
Is it all just one petition or?
Yes.
With separate names on it?
Yes. And what I'd like to say is that Peter has been our chief for 19 years. He served this town in many capacities for 30 years, often on a voluntary basis. He has shown that he is a capable, professional, well-educated, well-trained, responsible citizen and fire chief. He has proven time again that he only has the safety and best interests of the citizens of this town on his mind. This issue has been drawn out way too long. It is evident to many that he has acted appropriately and honestly. I've known Peter for 40 years, and he has always demonstrated professionalism and truly cares about the fire department and rescue squad and the citizens of this town and any other area that he has ever been involved in. I think if you look around and you bother to talk to the residents of this town, you will find that we all feel the same. If you do not, then you don't know Peter Martell. I urge you to vote to keep Peter as our fire chief. A negative vote will only disrupt the efficiency of the fire department and the safety of this town. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. Anybody else wish to address the board this evening? Rudy? Welcome, sir.
Thank you. My name is Rudy Heller, resident of Brookfield, and Peter is not only a hard-working, dedicated resident and worker for the town, but he has saved many lives, including my own. And I think there'll be many people here or in town who will attest to the same thing. So I think that you should keep that in mind in making any decisions about Mr. Martell.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Anybody else wish to address the board? Gotcha. I'm going to ask this once that the applause stop. I appreciate the first round, but we're not going to continue this. This is a Board of Selectmen's meeting. If we cannot, we'll move this into the Selectmen's office. Are we okay with that? Thank you. David, did you have a... Welcome, sir.
Welcome, evening. If I knew there was going to be this many people, I would have borrowed the popcorn machine from the Culture Council. Okay. First off, I want to thank all the people that overwhelmingly supported me on my sign over the newspaper columns in the different papers. Very, very overwhelming. I couldn't believe the support. One guy stated that, he says, that tells you that people want the truth. And also, they want to know what's going on in the town. So I want to thank everyone very humbly, not all you people, but all the people throughout the towns that I've been in. Okay, next. Okay, we met with the Highway Department and the Advisory Board, and that went pretty good. We got a lot of data from them. Some of the figures we weren't really in agreeance with, but we are going to go over it and come up with a budget. As far as now the next thing, I'm going to do a different take. You may have a great, or you may think we have a great fire chief, which I'm sure we do, and he's been in service for a long time, but we have an integrity problem here. When someone's been in working for our town for many years, our town or other towns, if there's an integrity problem, you can't keep somebody on. He got caught attempting to embezzle money for an electric bill that he submitted in writing.
Order, please, please, seriously. I'm about this close to bringing this into the Selectmen's office and just close.
I'm on the advisory board. We're trying to save money for the town. He put a bill in, attempted to get his own personal bill paid through the town, along with the two electric bills from the firehouse. Facts are the facts. We cannot keep, once this happens, we have no trust or integrity in this employee. Cannot continue on with an employee like this. If it's our town or another town, it doesn't matter how good of an employee is, but once you do something like this, everything's out the window. When you have no integrity, you cannot trust this person in any capacity as an employee in this town. And I know a lot of you are biased, and I'm not going to say anything against that. That's fine. I'm looking at it from a financial point of view and an integrity in our town. We can't have our town run with this type of behavior with the money. I'm a taxpayer. He's taking money from us, or he attempted to. It didn't happen. So I urge you three selectmen to do what's right for the townspeople. This isn't about personalities with the chief. It's not about politics. It's simply based on an employee who did wrong, and you can't discipline him. You can never trust this person again. He did wrong, and you have to do what's right for the townspeople. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Anybody else wish to address the board? Donna?
John David.
Yes.
My name's Donna LaFleur. I'm the chief of the ambulance squad. I'm also a firefighter. And I think what's been going on is terrible. None of us are perfect. We've all made mistakes. I've made mistakes on bills. But that's what the accountant is for. She is the one who looks at it and decides if it's real or not. He's got his name and his address right on the bill. How would anybody who's attempting to extort money from the town think that that would pass through? The accountant did what she was supposed to do. She noticed it right away. She called them. He came right over and picked it up. It was never paid. It never went any farther than the treasurer. So this seems like it's just ridiculous how this has been carried on for a simple mistake that we all make. None of us is perfect. You signed it. That was a mistake. None of us are perfect.
I didn't sign it. I was the one who pulled the bill. I saw it.
Okay. But there's been mistakes where you signed things where you said you didn't know what you signed. But we all make mistakes, and this was a simple mistake. Nothing was paid from the town. It was probably a $40 bill, and he did not mean for it to go in. He's been doing this, paying bills, for over 30 years, and it hasn't happened before that anyone has ever seen. You did an audit, went back several years, and the audit showed no other malfeasance, no intention of defrauding the town. And if he goes, that means the ambulance can't go out during the day. How many people are going to find to work 12 hours a day during the week? All of us, all the EMTs and all the paramedics, we all have full-time jobs except for me. So I'm the only one available, and I cannot go on call. We also have North Brookfield who's paying us to do their ALS. We'll have to pay them back their money because we can't provide ALS with one person.
So with that on the table, isn't it a huge issue that we only have 1.5 people down there that's serving two towns? You just claim Peter's the only full-time plus yourself?
Yes. Oh, I'm not full-time. Peter's the only full-time one.
If we have basically 1.5 persons down there and the rest are working full-time jobs, is that a disservice to the town of Brookfield?
It'd be great to have two full-time people, but it'd be very expensive for the town.
Should we rethink our contract with North Brookfield?
Only if we don't have Peter. People come in, they'll work 8 hours. East Brookfield will have 8-hour shifts. And in between the morning and the afternoon, they don't have ALS. And we provide ALS to East Brookfield, too. It's hard to find someone, a paramedic, willing to take the salary that we are giving and to cover that many hours, 12 hours a day. Plus, when someone's sick or someone can't do their shift, he takes it over, or I take it over. We share it between the two of us. And you don't find people with that dedication to the town. We had two bad storms that he slept in the station all night because if the radios go down, he could do it. He could get the generator going and do the radio traffic from here because New Braintree wouldn't do it. How many people would sleep at the fire station to do this? He's all around. He does fire, ambulance, emergency services for the civil defense, and has been doing it many years, and there's never been a problem with any bills, and I think this is just a fluke. It's just a mistake, and we're all prone to mistakes like every now and then.
Thank you. Okay. Anybody else? Beth?
Welcome, ma'am.
Thank you. I hate following Donna.
Following who?
I hate following the captain of our EMT because of the fact that she's just very passionate about what she has to say.
I think everybody in this room's passionate. These three people behind this desk are passionate.
Absolutely. And I'd say all I can do is echo that none of us is perfect. Peter made a mistake. Chief Martel made a mistake. I don't know what service we do the town if we compound that mistake. Other people have made other genuine paperwork errors, and you know, it's hard for the town not to be, to overreact, given what we went through a couple years ago with the wholesale embezzlement that was going on from the town. I get that. It's easy to get into a situation where you see something that might even whiff of being an integrity issue or a money issue and have a really reactive response to it. But the situation surrounding this, I've put the wrong check in an envelope to the wrong person, okay? I'll raise my hand and say that I've made that mistake. I've sent an electric bill to the gas company and a gas bill to the electric company in a different town that I was living in when I had both bills, okay? It's possible when you're filling out one of these forms that gets turned over to the accountant, you're only looking at, here's the vendor, here's the amount, here's the account it's supposed to get pulled out of. Those are the things that are on that form. If you don't look over at the service address, it would be easy to make that sort of mistake. It sounds like, and I'm not privy to whatever the accountant may or may not have found when she went back and did however many years that she did of reviewing the books, okay? But it doesn't sound like, I haven't heard any, you know, word kicking around from anybody that's talked to her directly about anything that really stood out as being some sort of systemic, programmed, conscious attempt to in some way defraud the town. So that to me is in part a big piece of the question, is what was the intent and what is the cost to the town on a lot of different levels, okay, versus what harm potentially was or wasn't done. Great that the accountant did her job exactly. We're getting much more conscientious about looking at our procedures, about looking at how people are following them. It's a good trend, you know, to start getting more conscientious about those procedures now that people, I think, are very sensitized to them. So I think there's a lot of lessons learned, not just by Peter, but by a lot of folks surrounding this whole circumstance, and hopefully we can all learn from it.
Thank you. Anybody else wish to address the board this evening? Last shot, Peter. Welcome, sir. Thank you.
Peter O'Connell. I've regretted the way this whole thing has developed, but it's understandable that from time to time things happen. People do make mistakes. I don't think that the question of the submittal of the bill in error is the main issue, though, that we're here about tonight. I think it's a bigger set of issues that has come down to focus on one particular thing, but the focus on that issue is not the real issue. It's really a whole set of issues. But I want to back up a minute, and I say that Trudy and I have lived in town 43 years. We're still newcomers for a lot of you, I'm sure, but over those years, we've been pretty active in town. We've served on boards. We've tried to be good, active citizens, as I think all of you have. And just looking back over the years, I was struck by two things, or multiple things. But one is, we're here. We have Pete Martell, whose family, I think he's the third generation public servant here. The Martells have been very active in town as treasurer, as people in the fire department, as running the highway department, and so on. And by the same token, you've got Linda's family. I don't know, are you third generation public servant as well? Your dad?
Yeah, before my dad.
Your dad thought correctly. He was a good Democrat. But really, you have two families here, and we're kind of represented here on both sides in a certain way of the table, the Selectmen and Pete Martell. Nobody, no family, no individuals stay involved in town that much unless they're really dedicated to the town. And by the same token, over all of those years, they get things attached to them that, you know, it's like imagine people kind of walking around with a bunch of sticky notes about all the things they did wrong over the years. It's a sad fact about serving in public service that people remember the things you do wrong and they hold them against you for a long time, but you rarely hear when you're doing a good job. And so I want to say, to Linda, particularly, and to a lesser extent, you've got a long future ahead of you. Thank you for your service. This is not an easy job, and I know of what I speak. On the one hand, and to the Martell family in general, thank them for all of their service. A tremendous amount of experience and expertise that we need to value in a situation like this. We need to remember that the town is built around these people who take the time out of their lives and serve with no pay or too little pay, for the most part. No pay, too little pay. So I just want to say that, and as we think about what to do here in this particular circumstance, to say, let's not forget that. Let's treasure that kind of experience. Let's build around it. Let's not let a particular thing throw all of that out the window. I have to disagree with Mr. Holcraft on this one instance. Who among us hasn't made a mistake? I remember the former town accountant, she said part of her job was keeping the department heads out of trouble. You know, she would often send things back to them she had caught, and I won't mention any names about who she was trying to keep out of trouble. So a second thing, I've emailed the selectmen my view on this whole issue over the acquisition of the chief's vehicle. I think the process that I don't even know if we can call it a process, but there were a lot of problems with this, the way the police chief and the fire chief went about acquiring their vehicles. It was a different process than we've used in the past. In the past, the town voted on individual new vehicles. This particular time, we transferred money, but we didn't transfer it with specific vehicles in mind. It was left to the selectmen to administer that process, if I'm correct about that. In the past, we had a capital planning committee that had anticipated particular expenses and tried to plan for them. That committee has been non-functioning for a couple of years. So we didn't have a capital plan in place. The selectmen thought they were communicating with the fire chief. The fire chief thought he was communicating with the selectmen. There's disputes about this process, but functionally, it didn't work. It didn't work. The selectmen finally did accept the vehicle. That part of the problem has been resolved. What we're doing now is trying to assess blame. And for me, looking back over the years, when a town has come to a situation like this, and they focus on blame, and trying to single out a person for blame, it's the town that ends up suffering. People's egos get bruised. People get mad. People quit. And to a large extent, that problem festers for years. If we don't make a good decision about this, if you don't make a good decision about this, if the fire department doesn't make a good decision about this, then the town is going to suffer. And we've seen the examples of that in the past. And frankly, I think the divisive environment in the town right now has contributed to this suspicion and distrust between the Board of Selectmen and the department heads. This atmosphere of name-calling and blame, I think, has got to go. I felt strongly enough about this that I helped circulate the petition. So I talked to about 50 people. And I would say there were some people who said, you know, the fire chief should have gone to the Board of the Selectmen. Other people say, the selectmen should have gone to the fire chief, you know. But almost unanimously, they said the environment, this kind of uncivil environment, is contributing to the problem. It's creating a number of problems, and this is only one of them. So I feel like we have to, going back to the beginning point, I think we have to value the commitment of people on this side of the table, Linda in particular. I think we have to value the contributions of the people in the fire department, the police department, all of you who serve on committees. I think we really need to value all of that and not let this specific issue fester to get by it, to reinstate the fire chief in his position, and then at the same time reestablish and reaffirm the Board of Selectmen's procedure for capital purchases and its authority to manage that process, and in fact to manage that process, which I don't think really happened as well as we said. So to finish, I think we're at a kind of fork in the road here. If we go down one fork and focus on blame, and as if it's one person's problem, man, that's gonna be a bad situation. We're gonna have legal problems. We're gonna have suits. It's gonna go on for a long time, and all of us are gonna suffer from it. And I hate to see that. I think if the selectmen reinstate Pete and then have a conversation with the fire department and reaffirm those procedures going forward, we'll get by this issue and we'll have taken the first step toward reestablishing trust and good communication and the kind of teamwork that towns like we depend on. Thank you very much.
Anybody else wish to address the board this evening? Yes, sir. Welcome, sir.
Thank you. I'm what you call a newbie to the town. Probably been here about 10 years. I come from a real small town up in New York, which I was fire chief of the local fire department for about 25 years. I thought we were coming here tonight to talk about something really important. But I guess what I learned is that things went the way they should have gone. Somebody made a mistake. It was caught the way it should have been. And it was an innocent mistake. So I really have a hard time how anybody can call somebody that untrustworthy when they make a mistake like this. This is absolutely ridiculous. You know, if somebody actually tried to steal the money, that'd be a different story. You know, in one thing, you know, if I look around this town and look at the other towns around, the highway department is far superior than most of the towns around here. The rescue squad, I can't say enough about. I've had to use them a couple times in emergencies, and they work great. And I think people sometimes don't appreciate what they really have here. The town that I come from, up in New York, if you want to go to a hospital, you're 25 to 30 miles away. And it's all volunteer rescue squad, with not much for personnel. And so I really have to applaud this town for the highway department that they have, that I can see, live down by the bridge that's defunct, and the use that I've had to have the rescue squad. I think they deserve a lot of, not criticism, a lot of congratulations for what they get done, for what they get paid. Thank you.
My name's Glenna Pearson. I've lived in 32 River Street. I've lived in Brookfield for a little over 40 years. My children gone to church, gone to school with a lot of other people's children here in Brookfield and Tantasqua. When my 40-year-old was about two, Peter came and helped. He had swallowed something and helped get it out and helped save him. I have felt secure in this town. I have felt cared for in this town because of Peter Martell. I knew his mom. You know, when the kids were going to school, they've all served this town. If somebody's done 38 years of work, I can't see being criticized for a couple of mistakes. I was a teacher for 30 years. I made mistakes. My principal would call me and we'd discuss it and take care of it. We certainly didn't put it on the news. We didn't advertise it to the whole world. We worked out our mistakes. I don't understand why we have to have this big forum, because Peter made a couple of mistakes after 38 years of service to our town. I see him all the time, at everything. He's there, he's serving our town. He cares about us. Do we want to hire somebody that's just doing it to do a job? He cares about our town. He makes me feel secure. I want you to keep him, and I think it's time for a dinner in his honor, because of the service he's given to our town. I just don't even understand this at all, because he's taking care of us. And you know, if I have a fire, you guys aren't going to help me out. He's going to be there, and these other guys are going to be there, and they're going to take care of me. I feel secure because of Peter and all that he's done. I can't imagine replacing him. Who would you ever get that would care as much about our town as he does? I don't get it. Thank you.
Anybody else who should support this evening? No? Did I see a hand in the back? No?
All right. Agenda, item number one, designating a police contact liaison and setting negotiation dates. We have been contacted by the union in regards to potential dates. Those dates have passed, unfortunately, because we haven't met by then. So first and foremost, we need a designee that's going to start the negotiations.
Not on my plate.
I can't do it. I'm already the designee for the school.
So I'd be happy to serve.
Okay. Good.
So I'll entertain a motion to appoint myself as a designee for the police contract liaison.
I will make that motion.
A second.
Any discussion? Hearing none, all in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Can you please reach out to Sergeant Pariseau and let him know? And then
he's here. He's up in the back.
Sergeant Paraso, we will officially email you and get that going. And you're good with 6 a.m.?
Sure.
Did we take a vote on that? All in favor?
We're about to.
All in favor?
Aye.
All right, thank you. All right. Open meeting law complaint acknowledgments, item number 2, first and foremost. Open meeting law complaint from Peter Martell, dated February 27, 2017, concerning an alleged violation of the open meeting law, knowledge receipt of complaint, which we're doing now, and consider possible responses thereto, and vote to resolve the same. This is a second complaint by our Fire Chief, Mr. Martell, claiming at a meeting of the Brookfield Board of Selectmen on January 31st, 2017, Mrs. Lincoln made comments about me that regarded my character and or reputation. I was not afforded protection under the open meeting law. He requests that Ms. Lincoln should publicly acknowledge that her comments were inappropriate. Since they were based on you, Ms. Lincoln, I will let you speak.
Well, I didn't feel that I didn't name anybody when I made that comment because I have listened to the tape. I didn't have a name, so I don't feel that this is a violation of open meeting law because it was said in an open meeting.
I think we should have care. I mean, that's probably the point, is that we should take care.
I will take care. Yeah, in further meetings, I will take care and not mention people's names.
So, reaching out to town council in regards to a response, at the outset, it must be noted that this is the second open meeting law complaint filed by Mr. Martell. His complaint dated February 8th, 2017, alleged that the notice provided to him on January 10th, 2017, executive session pursuant to General Law Chapter 30A, Section 21A1, was not specific enough. As explained in the board's response to that complaint enclosed, which we took care of last time, the board had no obligation to provide more specific notice to him. And the subject of the executive session then was in fact provided. Of note, Mr. Martell requested that this executive session be held in the open and was his right and was during the subsequent open session discussion issued concerning the propriety of Mr. Martell's purchase of a fire vehicle, among other issues, were disclosed. Context is relevant to Mr. Martell's second complaint. The general discussion on January 31st had to do with the process through which the fire vehicle was purchased and ultimately whether to approve the transaction or return the vehicle. And this is the one that we're talking about currently. One of the items listed on the meeting notice for the discussion in open session was 2017 Ford Expedition discussion. Copy of the meeting notice is enclosed here within. For your reference, the scope of such discussion includes the means by which the 2017 Ford Expedition was purchased, policies for acquisition of town vehicles, and the disposition of the fire vehicle upon learning that it could not be returned. And it also notes the videotape meeting. In any event, without knowing the precise comment that Mr. Martell objects to having been made in open session discussion, the open meeting law simply does not require that the board enter executive session to discuss someone's character or reputation. And it references Mass General Law, open meeting laws. So I will entertain a motion to submit this as a response and a denial to violating an open meeting law. Yeah, you should. Yeah. You're a member of the board.
You can. Yeah, you're allowed to do that.
I'll make the motion that we send that.
Second.
Any further discussion? Are you all in favor?
Aye.
Item number 3, open meeting law complaint acknowledgement. Open meeting law complaint from Matthew Graves. Updated concerning an alleged violation of the open meeting law. Acknowledge receipt of complaint. Consider possible responses thereto and vote to resolve the same. A complaint by Mr. Graves was made on his entrance of the building. The handicap ramp door was locked for the Board of Selectmen's meeting on February 21st, 2017. I arrived shortly after the meeting started and found two women who were on the handicap ramp that couldn't get into the building for the meeting. I was able to assist both of them into the town hall for the meeting. They stated that the door was closed and locked. Both were upset that they might miss the meeting. It was worth noting that this isn't the first time that this door has been locked during a public meeting, which I'm sure is just an oversight.
Ensure that the town hall, this is his request, ensure that the town hall is accessible to all by unlocking the handicap ramp door at all meetings. All town committees and boards should be notified that the handicap ramp door be checked and unlocked prior to their meetings. So I want to be as professional as I can, which I really do attempt. Mr. Graves, why didn't you bring it, you came to this meeting, why didn't you bring it to our attention as opposed to filing something against the town that the town has to pay for?
I didn't want to interrupt you.
Really?
I didn't cross on Linda, bring it up to you after that. When I walked in.
During or after? But you felt it necessary to file an ethics charge against the town of Brookfield?
Yeah.
Okay. And this, people, is why we have issues in the town of Brookfield. The fact was, without reading this, is... Wait a minute, what? I'll entertain any discussion. Anybody wish to have a discussion?
Yes, I do.
Okay, welcome, sir. Why don't you come on up? Thank you.
My name is George Fortier.
Welcome, sir.
And my discussion on that is brief. In the complaint, Mr. Graves does state that he feels that was an oversight. It was a mistake, which I think directly speaks to what we've been talking about this entire meeting so far, is a mistake that was made. A very simple mistake that can be easily corrected. It was submitted in writing so that it can't be overlooked, because so many things do go overlooked. So now you have to look at it. It has to be put down. It has to be seen in writing for you to go, okay, I have to set up the cameras. I have to set up the microphones. I have to set up water for people to drink. I have to unlock the handicap door. There's no denying it now. A mistake was made. There's no denying a mistake was made. Now we need to move forward and correct it.
So are you speaking on his behalf?
I'm speaking on the behalf of the town. I'm speaking on behalf of...
So we're going to play games, as Mr. Snyder said in his Boston Globe article, that this is what we need to do, is continue to play games and go tit for tat?
No.
All Mr. Graves had to do, if he wanted to get into writing, was to simply send an email, if he didn't want to interrupt the meeting or talk to us after, send an email to our administrative assistant, who has claimed that it was an oversight, it was a mistake, and we're admitting to that. The letter that's going to be submitted to ethics states that Mr. Siri used to have office hours on Tuesdays. Karen did not know the door was locked. Knowing that Mr. Siri doesn't have office hours on Tuesday anymore, that's what's going to occur. So this is that tit for tat that's going on, that's bogging down the town of Brookfield. And I had this discussion with Mr. Chafee yesterday, same exact discussion, because he filed one against the advisory committee that they have to address.
It can be seen as a tit for tat, or it can be seen as a simple matter of protocol.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Matt.
Matthew Graves. Thank you, George. It was an oversight on my part not to bring it up when I came into the meeting, but at the same time, if I had brought up the meeting, I still would have filed the same complaint, because it needed to be filed. If there's an open law, meeting law complaint, you're supposed to file an open meeting law complaint form, which I did. I don't think it needed to rise to the level of going to town council or anything beyond that, because it was an oversight. It's a door that was left locked. It's the only handicapped door that the town hall has.
You filed an ethics violation that had to be addressed.
Yes.
Town council had to address it.
Okay.
All right. Anybody else wish to address the board? Yes, Beth.
I am not the speaker that Peter O'Connell is, but I think this actually does set the example of, we've got the wrong energy in the room. These things right now, we're dealing with sins of the fathers before we walked in here tonight.
Okay. This right here is a direct correlation. You heard it from a gentleman speak first to this. Direct correlation for the actions that Peter Martell caused himself. This board is reacting to what Peter did.
Okay, so that's not what I'm saying. Maybe I didn't communicate well.
You did. Continue.
Okay. So, open meeting violation, selectmen choose to send it to legal. It sounds like both from a standpoint of all of the people who are chairs on the various boards, as well as, quite frankly, the town employees who are filing these, even though everybody signs a little piece of paper that says that we did open meeting law training, clearly there's some misunderstandings about what we need to do in order to be compliant, okay? Some people thought that certain comments that were made in open meeting were a violation because they should have been in executive session. Turns out it's okay for them to be in open meeting. Okay, the door not being unlocked, we've had that issue and that trouble before. I haven't seen a lot of communication out to chairs of committees saying, hey, make sure you double check the handicap door if you're in the town hall. Again, it's we're moving back into the blame game instead of taking the energy down and saying, what's the problem? What pain point is it causing the town? And frankly, the people who were trying to get into the meeting were probably very upset by the fact that it was in the way of their ability to attend. Okay.
I apologize to those two women.
And so rather than getting angry that the complaint was filed, now we know it's there. Maybe we can establish a standard going forward that the best way to deal with something like this, first step is an informal, hey, you know what? It pained me that Mrs. So-and-so and Mrs. So-and-so couldn't get in the side door. I helped them get in the side door. Can we make sure that doesn't happen again? You know, but I don't think that level of trust existed at least up till tonight, okay? And it's not going to exist tomorrow, regardless of how anything works out tonight, because it's going to take some time for people to get past kind of that state that we're in right now, okay? But if we take the energy level back down and don't start getting worked up and getting angry about everything that's on the table tonight and try to start with a clean slate and say, look, here's the complaint. No, this is not a valid one. This is the complaint. There's a valid point. These folks couldn't get in the building. Let's get an email out to all the chairs and say, hey, make sure if you're having a nighttime meeting, you double check that back door. It's that simple.
All set, Beth?
Yeah, I'm all set.
Anybody else wish to address the board? So I will entertain a motion to send town council's response back to state ethics in regards to the violation.
I will make that motion.
Second.
Any discussion? Hearing none, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Item number four, awarding the town report printing. We have four estimates ranging from 11-1602 to 1480. Low bid for 400 copies, 124 pages for the town report. I will entertain a motion for Country Press, Lakeville, Mass. For $1,116.02.
I'll make the motion.
Second.
Any discussion? Hearing none, all in favor?
Aye.
Item number five, personal safety equipment policy. Clarence was charged with establishing, first and foremost, did you reach out to the highway department to request that they wear safety equipment?
I did.
Okay. Are they okay? They have it in house?
Yep. And they were wearing it. Because
so
they were doing trees the other day. So the what you have before you is...
After the acknowledgement, or...?
It was after the acknowledgement, sure, because that's what I saw.
But they were not wearing it prior? Did you confirm
not to
that?
Not to my knowledge. What I was asked to do, I conveyed, and I further conveyed to you or to the board that suggestion as to the language that we might use for the future.
So what's highlighted in this is your recommendation or?
A suggestion as to language that we should put in some document somewhere that says that the town promotes the use of personal protection equipment. And that it be dependent on if it's a guy on a lawnmower, he should be wearing ear protection. And if it's something more serious, he should add to that.
They should go in place for the water commissioners, anybody operating any kind of key.
Do you have a copy of this, Linda?
No, I don't.
So it reads that each department shall take the necessary actions to secure personal protective equipment as required by the work to be performed.
This equipment would include items ranging from ear protection when mowing to more involved items as demanding by the hazards of the work. I'd like to see it have a little bit more time.
I'm game. It's a draft. It's a draft.
Did you happen to find anything online that gave a template or?
No, it was either pages and paragraphs or it was something simple, and I thought we needed something simple and direct, that we promote the use of personal protection equipment and that we should use it to the extent necessary for the hazard of the job.
My knee jerk is you cite specifically ear protection when mowing.
I was trying to give a range of things to say, if you're on a mower, you use ear protection.
We have seen them, they do that.
Yeah, they do.
But when you go into that specificity, then you get into bulleting everything.
Fair shot. Your opportunity.
Well, I have no idea, but that's just, like I said, this is the first time I've read it.
Yeah, so I don't mind going back and looking and trying to add to it. Again, I was trying to make a simple statement to say that we promote the use of personal protection equipment.
But you probably also have hard hats included in it and safety glasses.
Well, I think
that's when you start to just...
To snowball.
Yeah.
I think there should be a short, precise, one or two sentence policy, and it should be a policy by the Board of Selectmen to every department.
I totally agree. And my only other question in submitting it that way was really what the right vehicle is to... Again, we don't have necessarily work instructions, and so we may be needing that next level of documentation.
Hey, did you reach out to Tantasco at all to see if they have anything?
I did not, no. This is just from my background.
Did you want to reach out to Mr. Wood to see if they have anything?
I could certainly do that.
Okay.
Yep.
But in the meantime, are you okay with Karen sending this to the department heads in two sentences?
I was intending that go straight away, so I'm all for it.
So Karen, can you please send this two-sentence excerpt from this email to all department heads stating that the board discussed safety in the workplace until a policy is established, that the board feels that this should be a minimum requirement to be followed? So I'm going to entertain a motion to that effect.
I'll make the motion.
No, second.
Any further discussion?
No.
Hearing none, all in favor?
Aye.
Wage authorizations, health agent, administration, for some reason they're not separate at request of Mr. Siri. He's requesting that they are grouped together. So there's three separate ones.
You really just have to cross out the names on the other two. I don't know why he did it that way.
But
that's
they're,
how they signed it. That's how
they're all stepping grade, same. They're all for the health department.
And he has one the same.
They're all health agent.
They're all on the board of health.
So how does Mike want this done? Single or in a group?
It's for each one of them. So I would just say vote individually. You vote it in a group, so I don't know.
Now, has this been something, I know in the past we used to vote at town meeting to let one of the...
Well, they're all for the same position.
Yeah, they're all for the same, but we used to, if I remember right, we used to vote at town meeting that people would vote on this saying that they would designate one of their board members to serve this position.
By signing this is all...
But, no, I know that. It's given the authorization, but did it go to the town meeting? So, we
used to do that. Is this something we have to do
tonight?
Yep.
Those are three different positions.
It's not. They're all listed health agent administration.
No, they are Title V administrator, transfer station administrator, and board of health agent. That's how the personnel board approved them in our meeting.
These are wrong, then.
That could be.
Yeah.
He presented three separate positions to us.
I'm going to ask that we table it then.
If that's where I'm headed. Is it something we have to do tonight?
No.
No.
They get paid.
Good.
And through discussion, it's going from $13.22 an hour to $15.53. That's quite a jump. So there should be some...
Yeah.
Rationale behind that. So we'll table that.
This one I have an issue with. I actually had a phone call from a resident looking to put on Mr. Clark as an emergency operator, a retiree. He was actually working without this board approving it, which set the town up for liability. He wasn't insured, he wasn't appointed, something happened. This individual, and the reason why I'm stating this is because he was upset that nobody was given the ability to apply for that position. It was just hired from within without going out for advertising.
Could we have Mr. Chafee come up and speak to us?
If you'd like. Herb, are you here?
Yeah, I'm standing back.
There we go. Did you want to speak to this?
Could you come up and speak to it? Because I had a
comment. They have to be advertised. Yep. He's already an emergency worker for the town.
He's,
yes, then. He is.
We haven't been able to find a wage authorization at all.
Good job.
We couldn't. Did you have anything to say, Linda?
Well, Mr. Chafee had called me the other day pertaining to this, and he said that happened the night that we had the blizzard, and he said that they didn't have enough men to, you know, cover the plowing. So he said he had to get two people in, and it was an emergency, and this is why he did it.
And so what's the issue? I mean, it's...
It was an emergency situation. He had to get somebody in to plow to be able to keep up with the roads.
And are we going to pay him?
Well, we have no choice but to pay him.
Sure.
But again, we're elected by individuals, and when somebody calls me and flags me, when I'm out in Spencer, I have no idea that Bruce Clark is snow blowing snow during a day, which is in the snow version.
This is my understanding, though, from Herb. Herb, if you can correct me if I'm wrong, you had told me that he was out plowing.
He plowed during the bad part of the storm that we had in the middle of the day.
Yep.
He helped out, him and the other gentleman.
Mm-hmm.
And once the snow dropped off, they went home. And we finished up until 3 o'clock in the morning. And Bruce, he come back in the following morning to give us a hand with sidewalks and stuff. We spent 10 hours doing sidewalks and breakdowns.
And the personnel board approved this?
Well, they approved it, yeah.
Okay. So
so you don't want to go out to bid for a position in town?
Well, I didn't think they had to.
We had an emergency. We solved it.
He had to
This is allowing him to move forward in all other storms. So we're literally hiring an individual.
Okay. And I don't expect to see another storm for a while, so... Mm-hmm. It's up to Herb to come back around.
It's up to the town to appoint.
Right.
But if it was an emergency, he had to get somebody here.
I get it, Linda. But by signing this, we employ that individual.
Sure.
Without going out and asking others if they want.
Absolutely.
And you're okay with that?
Exactly.
So entertain a motion to sign the wage authorization for Bruce Clark, emergency operator, at $19.38 an hour.
I make the motion.
I second it.
Any discussion?
No.
Hearing none, all in favor?
Aye.
So, is Mike coming back soon?
He's coming back next week.
Get these to him?
Yeah.
They're all the same. Do you want them separate? There is no other under number 7. Correspondence. Massachusetts Office of Disability is pleased to announce the Municipal Americans with Disability Act Improvement Grant Program application and selection process. Eligible applicants, including any Massachusetts city, town, special purpose district, and or regional governmental organization. Basically, it's a grant application. Have we forwarded this to CMRPC? I'm assuming they have. CMRPC has a copy of this.
It just came in today.
I haven't seen it.
Oh, I haven't seen it. Can we get?
Can
we
get? Can you get that around?
Yeah.
I'll make double sure. Thank you.
It wasn't me when I looked through things.
Yeah, I didn't see it in my email today.
Okay.
Yeah, that's important.
It didn't come in the email. It came in the.
Can we scan it and send it?
Yeah.
Great. Thanks.
So I'll scan it.
Thank you.
Quabog Connector. The Quabog Connector is a van that provides transportation service in the Quabog region. The van will follow a somewhat flexible route, going different places on different schedules. Towns served, including Brookfield, who can ride. Anyone from the town served can travel between or within those towns. Children ages 12 to 18 may ride alone with written parental permission. It says click here. This obviously was an email. The cost is $1 each way, $2 round trip. Hours of service are Monday through Friday, except holidays, 6:30 a.m. to 10:30 a.m. and 3:30 p.m. to 7:30 p.m. For those that are interested, we can't click this piece of paper. Website is Ride Connector, RideConnector.com, or you can call 413-544-3401. Charter Communications, very much appreciate the opportunity to provide cable service to the residents of our community and look forward to working with us in the future. Pursuant to their license agreement, as requested by the Massachusetts Department of Telecommunications and Cables, they've enclosed the following: billing practice and equipment notice, sample subscriber bills, sample subscriber work order, channel lineup card and rate information. If you'd like to view this, it is in our office. Or you can contact Miss Lucy at 774-243-9735. Any other issues on the agenda?
I just want to pass another piece of correspondence to you. Two copies to you, one for your role as the chairperson, one for Karen, for a record for tonight of correspondence, and one for the Zoning Board of Appeals. And Linda, this is your copy.
Oh, okay,
there's two for Steve, one for zoning. No, it's just for course for reference only for tonight. It took me until tonight to get the information.
Which is what?
A letter to Nick as far as a zoning enforcement opportunity.
You're submitting this, or
I've submitted as an individual.
What? Can you just let us know what it is? So it's the first time seeing it.
It's relates to 6 South Maple Street and the failure of that operation to have a valid special permit.
Which would be the infamous yellow sign, I'm assuming?
I wouldn't be surprised.
All right. Nick, are you here?
Yes, I am.
Would you like a copy of this now?
He's already received it.
He's already received it? So why do I have two copies?
One for you and as the chairman of the board, and one for the Zoning Board of Appeals, should you wish to pass it on to them. Or I can pass it on to someone else if you would
Nick,
like.
Have you given this to Charlie?
No.
I just received it tonight.
I'd be more than happy to drop it off with Charlie.
My belief is that this would be a zoning enforcement officer's issue, not a ZBA issue.
Because that's correct.
Nothing was petitioned.
That's correct.
So as long as Nick has it, totally your call if you want to drop that off with Charlie.
Yep, thank you.
Thank you. Anything else before the board? No?
Executive session.
Executive session exemption number one. Without reading this, I'm assuming that Mr. Martell is going to choose not to enter into executive session and do this publicly. Mr. Mm-hmm. Martell?
Mm-hmm.
Is he here?
Yes. In the hall.
He's in the hall? Thank you, ma'am. Welcome, sir. Have a seat. We are posted for an executive session, exemption number one, which would be to discuss the reputation, character, physical condition, mental health, rather than the professional competence of an individual, or discuss discipline or dismissal of or complaints or charges against a public officer, employee, or staff member, or individual. You have the right to enter into executive session or keep this one open for discussion.
No, open's fine.
Open's fine.
Okay.
Before we begin, I will warn the people in this crowd, if I hear one word that interrupts with this discussion, the room will be cleared and we will continue our meeting. We'll be in recess until the room is cleared and then we will continue again. Are we okay with that? We're going to respect this. Thank you. Welcome, sir. I'm going to tell you what, my neck's always out there and everyone's going to going to criticize me. It's always my fault, yada, yada. The people that came up here, I don't know if you heard them speaking in your defense. Move me. They did, truly. There's no doubt in my mind that you have a dedication to this town that is above and beyond, and I commend you for that.
Okay.
To do what you do, and we've had this discussion, and when what upsets me is that this discussion sullies the men and women in this room that do the same thing that you do. That hurts me as a resident of this town, as a leader of this town. The men and women in this room that run into buildings that people are running out of, and the men and women that go to car accidents or stroke victims or heart attack victims and brings them back to life or attempts to, they're angels. They're heaven sent, and this whole transaction sullies that. And I apologize to the men and women that do serve this town and other towns. I've seen other chiefs in this room as well. The issue at hand is something that stated back to several months ago was the purchase of the vehicle without talking to this board. That's why we originally brought you before this board.
Mm-hmm.
I believe it was Mr. O'Connell that made the comment that we should just deal with the situations and move on. We would have. This turned into a three-ring circus because of the emotions involved with it. My issue with the whole thing, and it's twofold, and unfortunately actually it's threefold because of the audit that occurred. You sat here for half an hour telling us that you were instructed by the chief of police on how to purchase the vehicle. Not once in that half hour did you mention the fact that our chief of police told you that you had to come before the board. When he told you that, your comment was, what's going to happen to me if I don't?
I don't remember saying that to him or to you.
The chief remembers that. I take issue with that. Unfortunately, in your position, you're an administrator. You oversee every single man and woman under your department. The buck stops at your desk.
Mm-hmm.
You did something wrong. I don't know if you admit it.
Well, what? Can we clarify what I did wrong then?
You purchased a vehicle without coming before this board.
Okay, where is the policy that says that needs to be done?
I don't have it on me. Mr. Snyder, if you have your policy book.
I do.
Okay.
It was a policy that was established solely for the fact of the account that you used the money out of for the purchase of that vehicle.
Okay, has that policy been followed that way since it was enacted?
The only one was Chief.
And he didn't follow
it. He didn't. He was told that he didn't. Before it was purchased, he came before the board.
He came before the board, certainly.
After the fact.
After the fact.
Yep.
And so, again, we got to work on our policy.
But what year was the policy?
June 1st, 2015.
No, you see.
The policy in question.
The policy in question.
I'm now confused.
I want to say it was 2014.
So 2013.
That relates specifically to the fleet replacement account, which the money was taken out of, which the money was transferred from a town meeting.
And so the question I had for you two meetings ago is what is precedent? Is it the 2013 document? What I believed I heard last week or the last meeting is that this policy has precedent. And again, I'm fine.
A month ago we discussed this. Michelle ruled that the policy that specifically talks to the fleet replacement account holds precedence.
Okay, so just so we're all clear.
But first and foremost, so we're all clear.
Yeah.
I don't think purchasing a vehicle and not following policy is a fireable offense. Do we understand that?
Mm-hmm.
That this got ramped up by a reporter and by people sending emails. Do we all understand this? Okay. We didn't walk into this room saying we're going to fire Peter because he didn't follow policy for purchasing a vehicle. Do we understand that? Are we clear? Are all three of us clear on that?
Again, Steve, I was just asked, did I have a policy? I've been working now for 4 weeks to take the 2015 document and make sure it's doubly clear to everyone. And so that's where I am today. And what I asked last meeting was, what has precedent? And I showed you the 2013 documents, which I have.
You showed me an email from Beth.
Yeah, yeah.
You showed me a policy. Yeah. You showed me something else that had nothing to do with it. And we talked about the policy that we've been talking about since day one.
And I asked, the 2013 documents are those documents. There were three documents. Two that relate to 2013 and one that Beth, I solicited input as to past practices, as to this policy, to make sure that we had the correct policies.
And those are all different issues.
They were. Yeah. And you're, and
the one that we're talking about now was the one, I believe it was Peter, Rudy, and myself.
That's
son.
Correct. 2013.
When Peter established, it was his leadership that established, and I commend him for it, because it allows us to buy vehicles when we need it.
Totally understand.
But there was a policy that was not followed for it.
That we, and again, what I was struggling with at our last meeting is, does that go in here?
We can incorporate it into it.
And that's what we agreed to the last time.
When we work on it.
So now what we did is, in 2015, we put this policy on the street, right? We had a past practice that kind of went by the wayside, I would say. And now what we have is, what we need to do is to put everything in this document so it is very clear.
But the document had gone out to all of the department heads.
Years ago.
No, this one did.
This one, well, this
that,
is the...
This one that, did, that, and a lot that, of work, that one, all of their input, all of the departments had given input into that, and that's why we had written it the way it was.
Yeah. And again, that's why you had two, and I won't say conflicting because that's a bad word to use, but you had two documents in different times of space. And what I was struggling with, and I asked, is I had three documents. You said one doesn't apply, the other two did apply, and there was one that was the later of the two, that document should find its way into this.
It should. It still exists.
Yeah. Oh,
It should still be followed.
Just so that you understand where we are. And we met earlier today for another hour, but we've gone through what goes on and what needs to go on and to incorporate. And we did, in fact, get just barely today, got to, whoops, where am I? The procurement section, where we're being very clear as to what the responsibilities are based on the 2013 document. So that's how far we are as of today with this document.
And I have no problem with that.
Yeah.
But
where I have a problem, and again, I voted to accept this policy day one of the job, and this is a good document. It needs, it's a couple of years old now, and again, now that I hate to use the word found, but we've had that 2013 document, you provided direction that needs to get in here, and that's what we're doing. We're going to work away at this thing and get this as best as we can. And the good news is we have good support again today with the department heads and the like and representatives of the departments that are really inputting to this. And the one thing I've learned in doing this kind of work in my past is by, in fact, being a part of the updating and answering of questions, you're a lot smarter about what that document says. And there were, to a point, if I look at this thing, there were 20, when we started this process, 27 questions or clarifications. That's good. So, I don't think I answered your question.
I don't know if I had a question, did I?
Well, now, we got some work to do, Steve.
In regards to?
Our friend here.
That's why we're here.
That's. I think what we need to do is, and again, I have a section in this document now that talks about acknowledgments, and that's what I
but see, this is the problem I'm having, and you keep reckoning back to that and to the sign-in sheet, and Peter's service to this town affords him a lot of things.
Okay.
One of them is the ability to know these policies and bylaws inside out. Since my tenure as a selectman, I remember even before when I moved into town, I would come to selectman meetings because I was that boring civil guy. And I'd sit there and I'd watch Peter in the back doing crosswords or whatever he did in the back, correcting the board of selectmen on policies and procedures.
He's been working at it again. Yeah, true story.
I would argue that there's no doubt in my mind that he knew the policy that we're talking about. I know, through talking with the chief of police, that he knew he had to come before this board. I know that he didn't mention it in our discussion with him for over half an hour. He kept reckoning that he took charge and leadership by the chief of police, who told him to come before the board.
And we should, for that, discipline for that.
And then also, who? I remember that night, too, that he came in. I had told him he should have talked to one of the board selectmen about this, and during that time, when he had done all the purchase and he had looked at all the different bids, our administrative assistant was out on sick leave, and I was in here practically every day. And he could have said something to me, because I was always in checking to make sure how things were going. And he could have said something to me what he was going to do, and he didn't.
So, and Mr. O'Connell talked about communication, that there was poor communication between both. I disagree. I've reached out to Peter at least twice, physically running into him and asking how the acquisition was going. Mm-hmm. Both times, chief of police needs to get his first, and then I'll come before the board. Never happened.
I didn't say I'd come before the board.
There was communication. Yeah. There was communication. There was communication by myself and the chief of police. That's how I knew he was planning on purchasing the vehicle and then telling him what the right procedure was.
So, by he, you mean the police chief or myself?
Police chief.
Okay. But also, he didn't appear before the board.
He did after I advised him that he was...
And the vehicle had been delivered.
So where we are is that we need a letter of reprimand. That, in fact, that we're going to follow the policy. And again, now that this will include the 2013 policy, that's what we're going to live to going forward.
My understanding was the 2013 policy applied to highway vehicles. I don't remember
it
that being distributed.
It started in 2011.
It was
highway.
It was the account specifically that was established.
And that was the point that Steve made at the last meeting. The 2011, the document that used to did not apply, mm-hmm. was related to highway equipment. But by 2013, you made it apply to everything.
Well, yeah, it was.
And again,
but and since it was at the request of the advisory committee because they wanted action in it as well.
In it.
But since the 2013 policy, there have been numerous purchases that didn't follow that.
Out of that account?
Out of the fleet? Does that?
The majority of purchases for vehicles were funded from an article on town.
But does 2013 say?
Specifically to that account. It speaks specifically to, we have that policy because of that account. So it wasn't,
but it wasn't
mishandled.
Because since 2013, we bought three police cruisers and one fire vehicle.
I got to find it now.
But the way I feel, though, where this, our fleet account is concerned, like, you had gone into the fleet account, mm-hmm. you know, you made up the voucher, but you failed to get another signature on it. You should have, Karen wasn't here, so you should have come to see one of us to get a signature to okay that this is what you were doing, but you didn't do it.
Again, there was, the policy book that Mr. Snyder said we've been working on, I have no recollection of ever getting. There was no policy. My talking to the police chief about it was for just asking him about his process, his vendors that he used, and I asked him, what policy, what procedures did you follow? What forms? What meetings did you go to? And he said, none. And it wasn't until after his vehicle came in that he said, you need to go before the board.
So what he told me was that he told you that he messed up and that you needed to come before the board. Did he or did he not tell you that?
I don't remember the exact wording, but the process
even
was already...
Even if I'm paraphrasing, did he or did he not paraphrase that statement to you?
I'm not. I trust Chief Blanchard. He said we had that conversation. I'll believe him. But the question is, why would he tell me that?
Why would he tell you that?
Yes.
Because he knew he made a mistake, and he's looking out for you. That's camaraderie.
Okay, right. But in fairness, he made a mistake. I made a mistake.
But he did come up, though. He had sent a secretary up, though, when he did for the acquisition of the vehicle, and he did have the administrative assistant did sign off on that because it was coming out of the fleet account.
So, see, these are the documents. It's 2011, and it works out that it's all equipment. One's just predating the other, but the other. And that's what I'm believing I should be putting in to the doc.
We'll have that discussion because it has to, and this is something that's not relevant to this as far as I'm concerned.
but seeing you having the conversation, it has to be referenced specifically to that account.
Oh, yeah.
Or we get rid of the account. If it's going to cause an issue, we get rid of the account. I think it's a good account. I think it puts this town in a position where we can get vehicles without going to a town meeting.
And we should have, but we have to have civics and we have to have policies that people go by and procedures.
And again, that was the question 2 weeks ago to say, do we want this in here? And I think we agreed to that.
So do we all agree that he did not follow policy?
Right.
Do we agree that he knew he did not follow policy?
I think we're gray, but
I think it's very black.
No. Okay, but I'm kind of gray to black. All right.
I respect that.
Yeah.
So that's that. So now it gets compounded with the fact that Linda brought forward the fact that he had, what are you looking for, Chuck?
Conservation meeting?
Probably in the kitchen. We have the issue that Linda brought forward with the electric.
And we have an audit. Yeah. And we have work to do.
We have work to do. And today, if you allow me to, I wrote a statement at home. I'd like to read my statement.
Go for it.
Okay. There has been suggestions that this is part of a targeted effort to remove the chief. From my perspective, the board has an obligation to the citizens and the taxpayers to make sure that the laws and the town's policies and procedures are followed. If we as a board ignore a situation when an employee submitted a personal bill by payment for the town, we just look into it, we would not have been doing our jobs. And that this board would look into the situation. The chief says it was an oversight and review by the town accountant, doesn't show any additional personal bills submitted for payment. It is important that we have conducted this review, which did not reveal some concerns under the conflicts of interest law and the possibility of procurement law as well. We have to address these concerns with the chief because that is our job, no matter how unpopular it makes us to some voters. And like Peter had stated, how when he was saying that how the generations in the town have been. I was brought up, I'm third generation here in town. I was brought up by my dad at a very young age to be involved in this community, and because I have a love for this community, and I'm involved with it, and I even volunteered as even a young teenager. I've been involved in town politics probably for over 45 years now, and I've devoted myself to the government now here for over 30, and I just want to see the town run on a certain way for the future generations that are our children and our grandchildren of this community. And if I didn't care about this community, I wouldn't have come out of retirement to run for selectmen.
If I may, I wholeheartedly agree and support what you just read with one minor exception. You said that what the issue itself, you just said I described it as an oversight. I wasn't nearly that polite. Me submitting that bill and getting wrapped up with the other bills was a stupid mistake.
Okay, well,
oversight is far too kind, and I appreciate that. But the overall theme of it, yes, it was a stupid mistake. I am incredibly glad the accountant caught it, and it got pulled, I think, the same day. It's incredibly unfortunate that the accountants had to spend this much time on the audit, and she only went back 2+ years and up to the future out of 31 years of submitting bills. So any pattern, I think, is pretty much just kind of backs up. And reading her, she said there's no sign of any intent. This was a stupid mistake. I skimp and I apply for grants anywhere from hundreds to hundreds of thousands of dollars. So any thought that me putting in a $60 electric bill to better myself just doesn't really pass any type of smell test that it was intentional. I'm not going to risk, the trust. And the audit needed to be done. I know there was an outcry against Mr. Snyder for the action, calling for the audit. It had to be done.
I didn't think it was an outcry.
Pardon?
I think it was commendable. I think the town
stopped.
Oh, no, I know. I know people weren't happy that he did. No, it had to be done. Okay. To reinforce the trust that this town's put in me for over 31 years, various department head positions, it had to be maintained. There's no question about that, And reviewing, when we wrapped up the audit, the accountant said 2.5 hours we sat and just reviewed the questions she had. And I had to apologize because she said, well, you had an answer for anything. I said, well, unfortunately, Carrie, I had an anecdote for everything. We've got anything from a chainsaw to laundry detergent. We talked it through because she has limited municipal experience, and this was basically a municipal experience, municipal accounting 101 on the kind of odd stuff that towns and fire departments in general cost. So the audit had to be done. There's no question about that. And I'm glad I knew from day one there wasn't going to be a pattern found. There weren't going to be any other things like that. So
because I had gone over all the things that she had gone over also. Mm-hmm. That's why Carrie had finished it off.
No, this is the textbook example of due diligence. The board had to do it. You know, I apologize to the accountant that in this busy budget time she had to do it. And I apologize, you know, to the residents and my staff that, you know, this is distracted from work that we all have to do.
There were good findings.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I've been on audits before. There are things that need to be improved, mm-hmm. and that's where I think we're headed.
She gave you all the recommendations, mm-hmm. on how you should. And one thing, though, I think that you should, you know, start looking for better prices for a lot of your things instead of just getting what is most convenient. Because I know a lot of times by the, you know, when the end of the year comes, and you have to have a lot of your equipment, you know, inspected, you don't have any money to pay for that. So you always have to come back for when we do the...
Generally, the end of the year issues was would be large expenses for failures or breakdowns. That's why I do inspections in July and August, so that it covers it right out there.
But I just think maybe you could, you know, be a little more frivolous in your spending, you know, and just try to get better prices than what you get.
Mm-hmm.
Wouldn't, you know, go out and use some of the procurement laws. I mean, and just get better prices for your spending.
On a lot of things, yeah.
Yeah.
Pardon me for interrupting, and I'm going digressing back to this morning, but one of the things that we found lacking in the procedure is the multiple choice. What was it?
Combis. Thank you.
Is another example where I think we need to look to those procedures, have a procedure here that we can work to. Towards and understand, but actually take advantage of those. And again, that was the staff this morning educating me on that process.
Because even the document that we've been reviewing over the last few meetings, where it references state procurement laws, it's an outdated version, and in the purchase of the vehicle, state procurement was followed. So there was no issue on the state end of it. So.
Okay, so we've talked about all three issues on the table. Compounded to me, I don't know. It's a stack. It's not you talk about wanting to establish policies and spending time with people establishing policies. We had a policy. It wasn't followed. It wasn't a $60 purchase. We're almost at $50,000. Mm-hmm. There's another bill in there for an air harness tank, an air harness setup for like $3,300. It keeps compounding.
The total vehicle would be just around $40,000, a little bit more than the last police chief, the vehicle the police chief bought.
Without asking once the Board of Selectmen's approval. Do you understand the issue?
I understand that, as long as we understand that there was no set policy. I'm not throwing Chief Blanchard under the bus. He's a dear coworker, but none of this has been followed. You know, whether it's equipment or vehicles, if we're using the 2013 policy, this is the fourth vehicle we bought from there. And again, when I first approached the police chief, it was strictly as a business thing, asking him, what vendor did you use? Were you happy with them? Who did you use for an upfitter? And then the last part of it was, what did you have to do with the board? Did you have to meet with them? Did you have to fill out any paperwork? And he said no. And it wasn't until he was spoken to by you once the vehicle came in, it was basically a CYA advice to me, you need to go and see them. Well, at that point, it had already been ordered. The process had already started. His process had ended without any board interaction. Mine had just started. And this was the third vehicle I think he bought from there. We had the two vehicles in 2015. In fact, one of the vehicles he bought, two of the 2015s, we approved at a town meeting, and he later told me you asked him to delay buying that vehicle until the fall. And that was when we were replacing the old SUV. Well, if he had to come before the board anyway, why would the need be to come to tell him ahead of time, delay that? And we finally got it because that was the previous vendor, which isn't nearly as reliable as who we're using now. And it's always that concern the vehicle wasn't going to be ready for winter.
Well, maybe though, like if the chief had said to you, you know, how he didn't follow the procedure, right? Mm-hmm. Maybe you should have done that the right way. You came to many of our meetings a lot of times, and you never mentioned it. Maybe you should have.
So I should have been the first one to follow this procedure, ever.
Well, if the chief had told you that he did it wrong, maybe you should have corrected it.
Who told the chief he did it wrong?
I did, because okay. I had that communication with okay. both you and him.
After his vehicle came in. I'm just looking for fairness here. We took the town meeting mandate. The town meeting was very clear what it was done, and we appropriated $85,000 for two vehicles. And I'm not saying we had to spend $42,500 per vehicle, but
you did
the that. Town was very clear what they were doing and what they wanted.
The town was clear that it was placed into account that was oversaw by the selectmen.
I think they were clear on the fact that they were buying two vehicles and what those
that
two vehicles
were.
They
were placing money into an account that was oversaw that had policies that you disobeyed. And my argument is now knowing that you disobeyed them.
Well, I don't know which policies were in effect. This large policy, we have no proof of that anybody ever got it. If the policy had gone, the large policy that went out had been distributed, why were none of the acknowledgments signed? And if it had been signed, we would have come back much sooner because the entire appendix section, which lifts all the forms, none of those forms are currently in use. Nobody in this town is using that policy.
Every department head had the ability to discuss that policy. Every department head sat in many meetings discussing that policy. Every department head knew that that policy had been implemented.
So why has nobody been following that policy in its entirety since it came out last June?
In regards to the one that Clarence has in front of him?
Yes.
Or the one in regards to the...
No, the large one that he's now revising.
I argue they are.
No.
Yeah.
Okay.
Well, what we have is we have a set of forms that were sent out. Seven were sent, eight were not. With that, we've already gotten through two sections, and both of the forms that were in the sections previously are not the forms that we're using today.
The form we through that vote, you talk about the forms at the end.
Yeah.
We were using the old forms until the Excel spreadsheets had been implemented.
And so now what?
So that had nothing to do with the policy. You're talking about forms that were submitted.
Okay. So to be clear, there were 15. There should have been reading the policy. There should have been 15 forms.
Mm-hmm.
There were seven. I mean, that's just fact,
mm-hmm.
right? What we've now done is we've gotten through the first two sections of the policy, and what we have are two documents that are going to come out and two documents that are going to go in that are later because they're better documents. So, again, I look to the staff and what they've done to provide better documentation.
You realize that Carrie was working on those Excel spreadsheets. You have access.
Again, Carrie was part of today's discussion.
Well, if you have been making changes, though, at these different meetings, I think you should let us
Well, no, he hasn't made any changes. He's taking recommendations.
But even the recommendations, I feel that you should get the recommendations to us.
Well,
so
he is.
We've
talked about having a meeting after this work is done.
But there have been changes to this policy distributed to the staff.
And what we learned as late as this morning.
Because there's been no changes to that policy, Peter. Oh. We've made no votes to change that policy right there.
Your office has made changes.
Put you guys back for a minute.
Fair enough.
So what we learned this morning was that I'm reading a document because we're reading it line by line, and what I did is I read a portion, and Cindy is sitting beside me reading her document, and it's oops, and it was two oops because the document she had and the document I had were different documents. Simple stuff.
Which we did in the meeting before. She had copies of the old document. We changed that for months. Before it was finished.
And so again,
I hand type every single page. I'm very familiar with that policy.
So now where we are, after today's document discussion,
mm-hmm.
is that we know that we are now dealing with one document. The original document sits here. What was distributed? This was what was distributed on in 2015. That's what I voted for. And that's what we're now working on is the improvements to that document.
Which I don't think anybody has an objection to.
Right, and you got what you received earlier were the first six pages with this red in your email, of the suggestions that were made at the first meeting. We've had the second meeting today, and what you'll see next week is another set. And what we agreed to last meeting was that when it gets to be enough for a meeting, we will sit down and we'll speak specific to go through the changes.
So again, the topic at hand is Chief Martell,
right,
and what this board is going to do because of the actions.
And I believe a letter of reprimand suggesting that first, the acknowledgement of the current document, that we are to follow this document, is probably the first step in making this better.
Are you familiar with the fact that he has a suspension on file for not obeying the Board of Selectmen?
That's correct.
So this flies in the face of our
progressive discipline. You have one document. You would have two documents as of tonight. A third would be based on our policies, would be termination.
Based on our policies, that it goes from the written verbal to a suspension to a termination.
So we're at suspension. We suspended.
We did. The first one was suspension without pay. I don't think a letter in his file.
The 24 hours, if I remember right.
It was for 2 days, wasn't it?
No, it was for one day.
One day.
And the basis behind that is still questionable, in my opinion. But.
And now, with this one, this would be the second. It would be a verbal and a written one that went in his file. And if it happened again, a third one, and then
that's
it would be termination.
That is termination. So I'll make the motion. Motion to reprimand. And to acknowledge, one, to acknowledge the June 1st, 2015 policy, along with the audit findings, that to take 30 days to address the significant audit findings. Significant is not the right word, but at least that's what I would motion.
One more time, what's the motion?
Yeah, one more.
I'll try it again.
Pretend Donald's here, write it down.
It's a motion to reprimand to acknowledge the June 1st, 2015 policy.
So what's the reprimand? Just a verbal reprimand?
A verbal and a written that goes in his file.
This is a written one. And it's a motion to reprimand to acknowledge the June 1st, 2015 policy and to within 30 days address the findings of the audit.
If you harken back, I think you're looking for a corrective action plan.
I like a corrective action plan even better.
And I know that Peter's been here a long time, and I mean, that he has used his budget, but I feel that maybe he should have somebody to help him oversee the budget so that he doesn't just do all this, you know,
that's,
this spending.
That's what we have the advisory committee for. That's what we
no,
have
it's
this,
not just
that,
the advisory
that's what,
committee.
That's what we have this board for.
I don't know if the town department would even want to.
Why should we have people babysit the department head?
Well, because we just noticed, you know, a lot of the spending that he has, he can look for better buys and better purchases. And maybe he could just be overseen by somebody to do this so that he doesn't.
We have the most frugal fire department in the area.
I think we have a frugal town. The only issue that I saw with that audit was the ethics. Issue
I
with,
know there
with,
is an ethics, but I
with
think
one,
a lot
with,
of the things
with
he
one,
buys
one
should look for better prices on it.
But I think that also goes to the point of separating. What we try to do is we try to do too much. Individuals try to do too much.
And that's my issue with Donna. If we only have two people down there and we're supplying service to two towns, that's a huge issue to me.
Quite honestly, that's the biggest thing that came out of tonight, yeah, is if we are not man to do what they do,
that's
we need
huge.
To man. Yeah.
And if you look at Peter's payroll, he's working 80 hours for 2 weeks plus, what, it was like 20 hours of overtime?
Thereabouts, yeah.
Yeah, we're doing
That's wrong.
Yeah.
Put it on the agenda for the next meeting.
For what? So we should micromanage Donna's department?
No. Look for a recommendation from Donna.
She's been running that for how long? I think
Donna,
she has a hell
give
of
us
a job.
Recommendation.
Get more people. She just said it. She doesn't have people that want to come out. You see signs, EMT training on telephone poles today.
She does do a good job. Donna does manage her time.
All right, we're digressing.
Well, we're not. This is all an issue.
It is. Because
if we fire him, we lose 80 hours plus 20 hours of overtime. If he has a heart attack, we lose 100 hours a week.
We got some work to do. So, should we
come I personally feel that it should be stronger than a writ warrant.
I have a motion on the floor that has not been seconded.
I'll second the motion.
I have a motion to reprimand and to acknowledge the June 1st, 2015 policy and address a corrective action plan based on the audit findings.
I will make that motion.
I'll second
the motion.
All right, thank you.
And through discussion, who's going to develop the plan?
I'm working.
I'm willing to work with you to work on it.
We'll schedule meetings together. How's that?
I'm willing to work on it.
Yeah. We've got to get this thing right.
Yes. And I'm willing to come in also whenever you have the department head meetings and work
we'll
on it.
We'll just post them.
Because I know the last two that you did, you had wanted to do them yourself because remember we were rotating.
Yeah.
So I'm willing to come in and sit down and work on these policies.
2 weeks.
So we got to get them right.
We're back in 2 weeks.
2 weeks? I was going 30 days.
No, you said today we were going to come back in 2 weeks.
We're going to come back for the
financial
plan.
Okay.
What I'm now talking about is the corrective action on the audit.
Oh, okay.
And I'm thinking that's a 30-day.
Oh, okay.
Right. I think we already said we tried to do something for 2 weeks and it didn't happen.
Yeah,
so let's take 30 days and get it done and report back to this board as to the corrective action plan based on the audit.
Okay.
Mr. Chairman?
Any further discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Okay, so what about any other
violations? We haven't taken it yet, and I will oppose that. I'm voting against.
Okay.
It carries. Peter?
What about all the other violations of that policy that I was just reprimanded for?
What do you mean?
Other purchases that violate anything from the 2011 to the 2013 to the 2015 policy.
We're going to develop a corrective action plan.
Okay.
I mean, we got some work to do.
Okay, fair enough. All right. And the plan, the 2015 plan, we have to follow exactly, including the appendices paperwork
absolutely.
From now on completely.
And if we're not, we're going to talk to the town accountant to say how in that process.
Because we were already authorized by the Selectmen's office to change it once. So we're going back to the original plan, the original document with appendices to the letter.
To the letter. And if we have, and if there needs to be, because of the things that we've learned in the last 4 weeks.
Because there were changes authorized and made, but we're going back.
We had two documents.
Mm-hmm.
We now have one document.
Oh, right.
Worst case, the
appendices are back to what's in the 2015.
That is correct.
Okay.
And what we need to now do. What we need to do is we need to work with the accountant to say, and if we have to put it at the bottom of it as a note to say we're using a later document based on the current findings, then that's what we're going to do. And that's the corrective action plan
that's
going to work
on. But until then, we're using that
This is the basis.
The appendix in there, and correct me if I'm wrong, I believe in discussion for implementing that policy, we talked about the fact that we haven't developed the new appendix.
And I can show you an example.
Well, I know them.
Yep.
They were from another town, so they didn't correlate with this town.
Correct.
And the administrative office's assistant was putting forward Excel spreadsheets. Correct.
This is what we're using today.
Excel spreadsheets. And we talked about in that meeting that we were going to use what we currently have until we had that Excel spreadsheet set.
Right.
So I believe what Peter's saying is going to that book is incorrect because we had the discussion that we're going to use what we have in place.
And
it would be an accounting nightmare to submit something different.
So what I'm saying is that the language of the original document has to be what we follow.
Correct. Which is what we should have been following.
But for 8+ months, nobody's been following it verbatim.
Maybe the verbatim would be good, yes. But the point is that we're going to work with the accountant and then the treasurer and the tax collector and making sure that we have the latest documents that as quickly as this board can.
Do you still have the Excel spreadsheets that
I have the ones that Crystal.
You told me that they were done.
No, they were not.
They were not. No, that's where our issue of 7 versus 15 documents comes from.
There
were 8 documents that I had to go search for, which I now have, and we have. And so what we can do is we can use this as the Bible
And it was all, and that might have been a miscommunication between you and Cindy, that there were multiple emails with corrections made.
And then one other thing I would like to say, address to Peter, is some people have told me that the reason you didn't communicate with me is because you and I don't talk.
No, I didn't communicate with the board because there was no precedent or policy to do so.
About anything. This is what people have mentioned, that you and I don't talk. You know, we're both professionals, and I feel we have to rise above that. Whatever differences we had in the past have to be put in the past, and we have to have communication with each other.
Yes.
And I'd like you to agree with that.
Yes, I mean...
We have to have communication.
Right. Well, you just said, you know, you're getting feedback from people. We need to rise above that. We need to rise above what a lot of people that are not sitting at this table are saying, good or bad.
People have told me this is why you didn't speak to me because of over the purchase of this vehicle, because you don't speak to me.
No.
But I think we have to rise above that now. And we're professionals. We're all working for the same.
Yeah,
we're working for the same thing, and we want progress to go on in this town. Yeah. So we have to communicate with each other.
The vehicle from the town meeting vote on was always in the best interest of the town.
But not just that, Peter. We have to communicate with everything, and you have to communicate with me too, because I'm also on this board.
Yes, I don't know a case where I haven't communicated with you where I need to communicate with you specifically.
I've had a lot of feedback from people that told me.
Well, again, feedback from people is not feedback from me.
We need to work on it.
And feedback's actually a very good word. It's the same thing when you use a radio wrong. It's the same basic noise from a lot of people.
What a handshake.
But but what Peter's saying is right. There's a lot of noise in this town that is.
But we're also talking about communications. We don't have department heads meetings anymore.
Had one today.
You just had one.
We have a department heads meetings where half a dozen department heads are invited. We don't have them at night anymore. They're not with the complete board anymore. The Board of Selectmen has not been involved in the budget for the last 3 years. So
we're involved. I sat in at the advisory committee meeting.
Right, with the advisory committee.
But that's the budget.
Well.
I think we're going off track.
No, I think this is, I agree with Peter that the information out there is wrong. And it's perpetuated by several media masses, and it's sad. It hurts this town.
It does.
It's true. And I keep stirring it up, too. Did you want that motion?
You did stir it up a little bit Sunday.
Sunday?
We have a question from Mrs. Norton.
I have a question.
Yep.
I'm Tammy Norton, I'm a resident of Brookfield, lifetime resident. Why are you putting in Peter's file a reprimand when other department heads or other people have obviously done it wrong? Because then it falls into his files, saying that he did something wrong, and you say what you did earlier. Well, the first step's this, second step's that, blah, 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 and then you terminate him. If you're going to do it for Peter, then you need to do it for the police department. And I have nothing against any department's
file. We have done it for other departments. We have done reprimands, and it's in their files. Peter's not the only one.
So for the police chief not following the procedure, did you put one in his file?
No.
We didn't.
Okay, so why would Peter get one?
As far as I'm concerned, my answer is that we superseded it.
Yeah.
We got it to the point before it came to here.
Which is a good point about even earlier.
It should not go in his file.
But the police chief...
Well, there were other... based on the...
Yeah, Tim. I do not want this to turn into me versus Mike Blanchard. I'll defend myself as much, but I'm not going to take Michael down with me. We've got a relationship that... You know, is enviable based locally and by other towns.
It's not going to.
But it's not.
She has a point. I'm not going to shut down the meeting because we don't agree with the conversation.
Oh, no. That wasn't the purpose. No.
Because I think we solved this matter.
What my point was, we need to talk to one another, to your point.
Yes, we do.
Where if the door is locked, unlock the door and go tell somebody that the door was locked, and we apologize for that. So we need to work on those. That's the kind of communication we need to work on.
We need communication.
And that was all. We need
civility.
And I've used the word decorum a couple of times.
You know where I stand on that.
Exactly.
You fought for it. My grandfather died for it.
Yep. So.
We good, Pete?
I'm.
And thank you for your service.
No, thank you.
But.
Yeah.
We have room for improvement, and this town has a lot of work to do.
Everybody does.
And I apologize that this last 10 weeks has been a drain on
all of us.
Far more than in this room, more on some than in this room, and fodder for some in this room. But we've all got work to do with the town. We're barely treading water on things. We need to be doing better on a lot of things. And this policy book does need to be, again, this came out in June. Nobody's been following it. I had to become the linchpin to do that. Well, that's unfortunate, but it's, you know, I'm the first one in, last one out kind of guy. So if it's over me, so be it. But it was done in the best interest of the town. The electric bill, again, you gave me a lot more credit. That was a stupid mistake, emphasis on stupid on my part. But 31 years, I've made mistakes in the past. I'll make them again. I'm human. But serving this town is not one of them. So.
And another statement I would like to make is someone had sent out an email to at least 150 people, and I was notified by it. Now I knew I was harassed. I call it, for 2 days with phone calls. People had my home phone. They were calling me, leaving messages on my answering machine, and they even got my cell phone number. So I'd like to know how my cell phone number was out there, and I don't appreciate that. And I think Mr. Comptoirs was on there too.
We had several calls.
I had more calls because it was specifically, it was my, I have it right here, I have an email here. And it's specifically my number to call and...
Can I see that email?
Yeah.
I haven't seen, I've heard about it. So when Linda brings this up, I love Linda to death. She's like my mom.
Right here.
I disagree, and I've told you this, Clarence. We put ourselves in this position. We take the arrows.
Oh, yeah.
We have to have thick skin.
Yep.
It hurts, it stings, but we get up.
This was the email that was sent out by somebody
up,
in this
we
room.
Move on.
I won't make
it.
Let me address this. Are you saying that as elected people, you should get phone calls from your constituency?
That
yes.
We shouldn't?
But not the phone calls that were made today, Peter.
It
went overboard.
I'm saying that we are, and you are elected officials, we are your constituents. Shouldn't you be interested in hearing from us when we have opinions? That is not harassment. That is information, and you have a chance to speak to us.
This was what was sent out, all these emails to these specific people.
It's because we have a democracy, Linda, and people
well,
can talk to each
and
other.
Yes, but why wasn't Mr. Snyder's on this? Why wasn't his number on this? Why was it just Mr. Comptoir's and mine?
Because I'm in the citizen, everyone. They got my number.
Ben. And even his.
I am not on any town department, no town committee. I am here to be the platform, accountable for that. That's what I'm interested in. And from what it sounds like, is the police chief also made a mistake in the ordering as well as the fire chief. And yet, one is up here sitting amongst you guys being chastised for how we went about doing it. And from what I'm hearing from Mr. Comptoir was,
we talked during. He actually submitted a bill. I believe Holly, I think I saw her walk in, submitted it to our administrative assistant. We knew about it. You can't order it without, she's a procurement officer as well. It didn't just happen because it was received. We knew about it prior. We didn't vote on it until it was after it was received, but we knew about it. It was done correctly as far as I'm concerned.
From my understanding that Clinton also spent some time and actions with the fire chief kind of knowing what the ordering process was, correct?
No.
No.
I asked him what the process was, how he interacted with the board
the
prior
chief,
to buying.
He didn't spend time with me.
But even in the policy, the 2015 policy, before it goes in the state law over it, which is the now outdated version is in there, the first question is, if you have any questions, contact the chief procurement officer or consult the state law. I contacted the chief procurement officer, and I followed state law. So in terms of, you know, legality of procurement, the vehicle is fine under
yes,
state law.
So with that, you kind of set him up for failure. You
knew that the police chief did make an error in that, and, you know, said, I apologize, you know, I didn't go about the project. But I know effort did you guys make to, you know, go to the fire chief and say, hey, the police chief did make a mistake, we just want to know that you're on CTA, bring to the board, get approval.
I spoke to him twice about it personally.
To the police chief?
To the fire chief.
The fire chief.
And once to the police chief in front of the fire station, where I learned that he was going through the procedure with his vehicle.
And it was specifically said that you need to go before the board.
To Michael, correct. And that's why he did it.
Once his vehicle came in.
To Michael. And then Michael portrayed it to the chief.
It's not Michael's job to portray it to Peter.
I agree. But okay. Peter knows policies inside and out.
Right, and the policy.
Is that signed?
No.
2015 update?
We're not talking about the 2015. We're talking one that predates that, which
2013.
11 or 13. I didn't see the correct one, but 11. Whatever one it was, Peter knows about it. He knew about it. He chose not to come to this board.
Well, actually, which one mentions the Capital Improvement Planning Committee?
11.
Okay. So by that
was a new one.
So by that policy,
because the advisory committee wanted input on anything over $10,000.
Well, the advisory board needs to read the bylaw that governs their job.
Marlene,
if they can.
I'm just curious about the warning. I can't remember the word you used. I was getting. Is there does that end at some point? What is the timeline that goes on before it's over?
It's just in the file.
It's in his file.
So that means if he does something wrong again, he gets fired?
No.
Well,
no.
That's what I'm saying.
That is a possibility, absolutely. Because of progressive discipline, it would be. But that you come to that point, and you now will have two letters in the file, and you make decisions based on those two letters in the file.
Yeah, my understanding of progressive discipline is, you know, whatever steps you use, if it's verbal and then written and then a warning or whatever you want to call it, they expire. And then if somebody does something wrong again a year or two down the road, you start again with the written and the verbal and all that. It doesn't last forever.
She's the expert on the employee handbook. I don't believe that's in the
I don't think it's in the employee handbook.
There's an employee handbook?
We don't have an employee handbook.
Oh, okay.
We are working on
that.
We have a policy, and it's in the selectman's office anytime you want to take a look at it. The letter stays in his file forever until the selectman want to pull it, and letters have been pulled from other employees' files.
Whether or not it stays in his file forever isn't my question. My question is, when does what he's going through now expire, and does he start fresh again? This should not be on his record forever, so if he makes one mistake, there's a problem that he could be fired.
This is on his record because these are revolving seats. We have three former selectmen in this room that have sat in these seats prior. And history really isn't memorized in the town of Brookfield. That's why we have policies, that's why we have records. So nobody after this board is going to remember that Peter's already been disciplined prior to this. That has to stay in this file to show some type of, unless the board wants to remove it.
Right. Because again, the first one's questionable.
I'm questioning when it should expire. So that 5 years down the road, if he makes a mistake, somebody can't go back to that and fire him.
I'd argue that it doesn't get removed. But we don't have a policy on that. We
Carrie might have some input on it.
She doesn't. We have a policy on it.
Just to be clear, Carrie, to Massachusetts is an at-will state, which means that technically we're not required to have any documentation requirement at all.
That's also true.
So, with that said, reprimands do not expire, but they are used to make judgment calls in the future. So again, with the fact that the board is a revolving board, we need to have that documentation. Nowhere do these documents expire. You can choose to refer to them in future records, but it is not required that they be removed. It is also not required that we even do them. But because we are a progressive disciplinary state or town entity, that's a policy that we follow. But as far as the state of Massachusetts is concerned, it is an at-will state. It is on the employee, if they have an argument against their dismissal. It's on the employee to prove that their employer was at fault.
I agree, and that's what we stated. But Peter, back to this email. I just read this. We thought, and I agree with both of you. We're civil servants.
Oh yeah, but.
But now I have an issue because should I be harassed at my place of business? My business number is on here. Is that right? And then we talk about the further last paragraph is basically there's a move afoot led by Steve. By Steve, again, remember how we talked about this when we started? It's all my fault. It's all Steve. I'm not being narcissistic. Nope. This is the mentality out there led by Beth Coughlin. This is her email. Please, let me finish.
Oh, I was going to offend you, but...
I appreciate it. To use the nuclear option with Chief Martell and not just potentially remove him as fire chief, but potentially discontinue his employment as our one full-time EMT in town, potentially leaving Brookfield and North Brookfield shorthanded and providing advanced lifesaver level support. Did I once mention removing Pete in any capacity? Have I ever talked to you about that?
We haven't talked in 10 weeks.
Is that my fault? Have I actively reached out to people in this crowd to come here and support the termination of Peter Martell? Beth, you should be ashamed of yourself.
Just
what, Peter? No, don't tell me easy.
Can I?
Everyone got this email and they're here to support Peter, and I appreciate that.
Can I make one comment?
But to claim that I'm quoting nuclear option to remove you.
Can I make
in
one
all
comment?
Capacity? That's ridiculous.
I also didn't receive that email.
I didn't.
And just to be clear, has anybody here been approached by me to be present here?
No.
Thank you.
Mr. Coughlin,
yes, Peter.
In the conversation, you did indicate to me that as far as you were concerned, Pete was done.
I said that?
Yes, you did.
Well, I apologize for that.
And you said it tonight?
I said it tonight? I didn't say it tonight.
You said that you thought that it should be more than a written warning.
It should be more than a written warning. I believe that he should be suspended.
So hold yourself.
I am accountable. Did I say that he should be terminated tonight?
It's over with. It's done.
We did a good job up until this.
I think it should be stopped.
Yes.
Which was probably the next day when it was revealed that he put the electrical bill on the account before we had any further information. Did I reach out to you further to say that I'm still adamant for that? All right then.
General.
So we're done. So I'm going to entertain a motion.
Excuse me.
Yeah, excuse me, ma'am. How?
My name is Terry.
Correct. All right. Back off for what, ma'am? I'm going to attack her because she personally attacked me.
You shouldn't.
Well, I should.
Well,
you can have your opinion. I'll have my opinion.
What you're doing is personal attacks. You're supposed to be a professional.
Personal attacks? I'm defending myself. So professionals can't defend themselves?
You should not attack someone like that.
Okay. Yes, Marlene.
I just have what I hope is a simple question. Does the warning that he's going on reinstate him as fire chief tonight? What is the status of that?
It does.
It does.
Yes.
Oh, Jesus.
And I apologize if that wasn't clear. So I'm going
to. I was going to ask before you gabbled everybody.
I'm
going
to entertain a motion. We haven't adjourned. I'm going to entertain a motion to reappoint Mr. Martell as the acting fire chief. I'm not going to.
Reinstate
as a fire chief.
Reinstate him.
You're making a motion.
I'm entertaining it. I'm not making it.
I'm asking Linda if she's making it.
I will make a motion.
And I'll second it.
Any discussion?
None.
No.
All in favor?
Aye.
Thank you, Marlene. Did I see another hand? Yes, ma'am.
I did not get that email.
I'm glad.
Somebody can.
I know that was going on. That's why I came tonight. I asked somebody who
I think I saw
their name on it. My question is, what is your response?
I believe I stated it right in the beginning that I was overwhelmed by it and that I appreciate it and I respect it.
You have made comments, though,
that I think he should be accountable for what he did? Yes, I do.
It did go to your house, Mrs. Person. It went to your husband.
My sentence?
It went to your husband and it did go to your house.
I'm sorry?
It did go to your house.
What went to my house?
This email, right?
It did not go to me.
Yes, but I'm sure you have communication with your husband.
I did not read it.
All right.
Oh. We need to work on this.
Continue, ma'am.
We need to work on this.
Continue, ma'am.
As our select people, and there's not that many people in this town, it is not evident to you that we here, people that sign petitions, would like you to make nice with Mr. Markell.
Did we not do that?
We did already.
Him for all this time and another meeting too. I mean,
as
I said when I was up there, when I was a teacher, you get together, work it out, and get it on with. I mean, there should not be a big deal about him putting that bill in. Is there a reason there's a big deal about him putting that bill in?
Did we work it out, Peter?
It's resolved.
Are we good?
It's resolved.
Are we moving forward?
We're back where we started.
Thank you.
We're where we were 11 weeks ago.
Is that tonight because...
We kept you, ma'am, you chose to be here.
Because of your actions.
That's your choice.
If I can speak on...
And we'll have choices when it comes to electing new selectmen.
One phrase, and I've got to put myself in one of these seats, and I don't remember where I learned it, but going back to civics, probably Mr. Bruno... The public has a right to criticize its government. The government doesn't have a right to criticize its public.
Entertain a motion to adjourn?
I motion to adjourn.
He didn't adjourn.
No, he had another motion.
There was someone
take
who wanted to speak.
And I'll second it.
Any discussion?
No, we're out of here.
All right. Thank you, everyone.